So why don't people repent? First thing is, like, we live in a world that's so broken and so full of hurt people and full of people in a situation where they don't feel like they can get out of the pattern that they're living in. And if any spiritual or philosophy oriented conversation, there's a giant elephant in the room, and it's why don't people repent? Why don't humans stop passionately doing what's wrong? And basically, to sum up, what we need to repent from is living a self-focused life. A life focused on pleasure, on popularity, on influence, on possessions and achievements and the life that people are chasing that is about pleasing themselves and making themselves purely the center of their existence. Which doesn't sound too bad, but when you're in a world with everyone doing that, it's all broken, And so it's like, why don't people repent then? Over and over and over again. Why is it such a hopeless situation where people are continually not changing? The human race is continually being extremely distant from its maximum potential of fulfilling life, right? On average, the human reaching their potential of living a fulfilling life worth living, or so far, and making a world worth living in. And so the first reason why people don't repent is pleasure, is we love sin. I used to steal from stores a lot, and a lot of times I wouldn't even care what I'm stealing. I would literally do it because I got a rush. I felt cool. I felt like I was breaking the rules and getting away with it, and I had power. And it was pleasurable, and that's nothing pleasure-wise compared to like sex and watching stuff I shouldn't watch and all that kind of stuff. It's because we naturally love sin. Being popular isn't necessarily a wrong thing in itself, but there's great pleasure in that, and people will go about being influential in negative ways to get to that level of popularity that they want, or being in a certain lifestyle that puts them in a reputation that they want to have that is not good. And it's all about themselves, right? And so the first reason is we love it. We love sin. We don't want to repent. Another thing we do that we use to not repent is compare ourselves to others, right? We compare ourselves to people that either do the same thing as us or worse, right? And so if I'm stealing candy from stores, lighters, like random stuff, little trees to put in my car, and it's cheap stuff, right? It's no big deal. There's bank robbers. There's people walk in stores with guns and rob them. So what's the big deal of me taking little stuff? And also, I can compare myself to people who do the same thing as me. There's a whole bunch of people that do it, so I can't be that bad, right? If that many people steal from stores, what's the big deal? If that many people are sleeping around, what's the big deal? And another. So we compare ourselves to others, and what we're doing is minimizing our sin. And a lot of times when we do that, we minimize sin in general. And so, for example, with the stealing thing is, me stealing from a store, taking a candy bar, the store does not suffer much consequences, right? And I can easily convince myself that I'm not doing anything wrong by thinking about the fact that no one really suffers consequences of me walking in the store and taking a lighter, putting it in my pocket, walking out. What's the big deal, right? But imagine if everyone did that. You know, a good way to realize how serious your sin actually is, if you think about every single person doing what you do wrong, you realize how wrong it actually is. And another thing with it is, like, minimizing sin and comparing with others is, like, you know, okay, maybe I'm stealing $40 cologne or something, and at least I'm not robbing it. I ain't breaking into cars and taking wallets, right? And you can easily trick yourself into believing that what you're doing isn't a big deal. But if you think about the fact that, imagine if everyone did it. And the whole reason why people are stealing, robbing banks and stuff, is because it starts, it's like a pyramid. You got people taking candy bars. You got people stealing from their siblings. You got people stealing from their parents, which is actually pretty high on the pyramid. You got people stealing from stores like I used to. And it keeps going up. And then you got people robbing banks. You got fraud. You got all these kind of dark, dark sins. And it's this pyramid. And it all starts with just the heart of a thief. Which, if I steal freaking one time, I take one thing from the store and it's worth $2. I still have the heart of a thief. I'm still a thief at heart, right? And same with lust, right? The reason, like with lust, you got people watching porn. You got people looking at each other wrong, like in public, like, which is weird. And it's not like I didn't used to do that. And then you got people, you got hookup culture, you got people sleeping around. You got people dating each other, and they wouldn't be dating each other if they weren't having sex. And it keeps piling up. And then you got rape at the top. You got sex trafficking. You got all this nasty stuff. And it comes from the heart of adultery. Which, you know, Jesus, when he came, he wasn't like, you know, he hated rape. But he didn't start there. He started with looking with lust, watching a girl walk by and thinking about it wrong, fantasizing about her in my head. That's how Jesus attacks sin, from the bottom of the pyramid to break the structure. And so basically we minimize our sin and we compare ourselves to others and we love it too. And another thing humans do, which is so detrimental to the soul, but we isolate. Isolation, we hide, we get away from others, right? We're living in some sort of, which actually, another thing I had, which these two can actually often pair together, isolation and addiction, right? We're addicted. We idolize our sin. We wake up and start thinking about things that are wrong, and we run to it as an escape. And so instead of going to others, and instead of socializing, and instead of allowing yourself to be seen, allowing your flaws to be seen, and especially seen by the ones who love you and are having a tough time fully loving you because you won't confess what you're going through. Not even confess, you won't share what you're going through. They can share your burdens with you, but not if you don't bring it up. You isolate, and you get away, and you choose the temporary pleasure, and you let your sin conquer you. Right? It's isolation. It's something I feel like everyone does to a certain extent, right? A lot of times, you know, I used to just keep to myself. And when I was bored, and I would do things I shouldn't. And instead of, like, talking about my siblings and the people I know really care about me, I'd rather just go be by myself and be in that pattern of sin. And it's a pattern, and oftentimes it's an addiction, right? When I was addicted, when I was smoking weed several times a day for 2 years, right? I obviously mostly got along with people who smoked weed, and I had a tough time socializing with people who didn't. And it was like an elephant in the room for me. Not, they didn't know, but they, like, certain people might have a sense that I'm hiding something from them, but when we isolate ourselves and keep our sin in secret, there's no chance of overcoming it. We are allowing our pleasure to take over us. And that's something so much people do. I made it sound really bad, and it is. But like I said, you can compare yourself to others. I'm not the only one who smokes weed and doesn't tell other people that I do it, right? Another thing people do is say there's no God. Say there's no God. There's no God. There's no supernatural significance of the events that take place that is not a coincidence. So there's no justice. So you can do what you want. Right? Maybe I don't do things that can get me in trouble, but I do things that can't get me in trouble. And there's no God, so it doesn't matter. I can keep to myself. I can isolate. I can do what I want. And something I just realized, and I almost forgot to mention, is with comparison and isolation can go hand in hand really well. Not necessarily good, but they really go together in our world. And a lot of times people find friend groups that they share the same sin with. And instead of talking about overcoming it, they embrace it together. And this is all over the place. I mean, this is literally like college, everywhere, right? And so instead of isolating to yourself, you isolate in a group. And that is a form of justification. And you're justifying yourself because you have a whole group of friends around you do the same things. And to them, to you, they are good people. Right? They're good people. They're your friends. So the things y'all do that you shouldn't, and you all do, maybe not at the same time, maybe at the same time, but or together, you hide it. You hide it from the rest of the world. And a lot of people do that. And see other groups that do the same. And so it's no big deal. And so basically what people do is compare themselves to others, you know, isolate either by themselves or in groups. They're minimizing sin. And another thing is, or they say there's no God, so it doesn't matter, which also tags along with a big reason is pride. Pride. I don't need to repent. Which goes on, pride is the root of it all. I should have just started by saying pride is why. Pleasure and pride together. And it's a very difficult thing for humans to realize where they're wrong and to realize they need a change. We're very, very habitual creatures. We're very routine-like beings. And when we realize something we have pleasure from and it's wrong, like, that's a hard thing to do. You love doing something and it is wrong, and you have all these excuses of why it's not a big deal. To actually realize that it is a big deal for your spirit is hard, and pride will make that impossible. The reason why it's hard is pride. We all have pride. I don't want to realize where I'm wrong. I don't want to change. And a big thing is fear of what people think. Right? I'm in a group of friends. This is hypothetical. And I'm in a world where a whole bunch of people are sleeping around. Everyone thinks it's cool, right? The cool kids are doing it, and half the reason why they're cool is because they're with the hottest girls, right? Or they get the most. And for me to shy away from that, I'll be an outsider. I'll be weird. I'll be like, what's wrong with that kid? He doesn't want to have sex. And so a big reason why we don't repent is we're afraid of what people think of us. And it's very, very self-focused, because we know that we have the opportunity to make a good example. And a lot of times it's annoying when you struggle in some way and somebody makes a good example. It's annoying. It's annoying because you realize from the other person that you need to do better. And so a lot of times if you choose to shy away, choose to separate yourself from the sin, but you can't separate yourself from the crowd. The crowd won't like you. They won't like that. And so sometimes people stay there just because of the popularity, the reputation. They don't want to be weird. So they just run with the crowd. And they're okay because everyone else is doing it. And the last thing is laziness. Laziness is so big. Because you know how much you can accomplish by being less lazy? Everyone. I'm lazy. And it's like, laziness can go in a lot of ways, because there's laziness that's like what I just said with the good example thing. It is so much easier to not shy, to not... When you're in a crowd of people who love sin, love pleasure, basically everyone loves sex, right? That's like the easiest way to put it. And especially high schools, colleges. And when you're there, and for you to step away from, you know, loving, talking about sex, going after it, chasing after it, and you, like, to most people, you look weird, right? One thing that keeps us from actually doing that is laziness. We're lazy. We don't want to deal with that struggle. And laziness is a trap. It's a tough one, because we're not bothering anyone when we're lazy. If I'm at home, I'm chilling. I ain't doing nothing productive. I ain't bothering anyone, though. What's the big deal? Okay, imagine the world if everyone did that. Everyone stayed at home on their phone, on social media, texting their buddies all day, not doing nothing productive, not even exercising, not even finding creative hobbies, like random things, random. Literally, there's so much random things you can do that are good and help you combat against laziness. And think about all the things we have in the world that are only possible by people not being lazy. Houses, road, everything. You know, I don't have to go on a big tangent of all the things that are required to be built without laziness. And it's a hard thing to get out of, because at first you won't see the fruit. You know, if you're lazy and you start being more productive, you start working out, right, for example, you won't immediately see the result. You quit smoking. I know this firsthand. You won't see. You won't immediately realize the good that comes out of it. So basically, we have love for sin. We compare ourselves to others. We're lazy. We're addicted. We isolate ourselves. We're afraid of what people think. We minimize the severity of sin. And we say there's no God. And basically, to sum it all up, what humans do, the reason why we don't repent, is pride. We don't need to. It's not a big deal. Especially me. Right? That's what we tell ourselves. And I think there's nothing more to say. But there's a cute little munchkin. So this was way longer than I actually expected it to be, but I hope it does well.